It's Giveaway Tuesday. We're talking about the WELS mobile app and all that can give to your daily walk with God. We're talking about listener reviews and ministry resources, and if you contribute to either of those categories, some special hardware giveaways. And finally, an all-new feature, and you have to stick around to the very end of the show to hear about a free musical download from one of our WELS artists. This is WELSTech, a show that explores the intersection of technology and ministry. WELSTech is a part of the Streams Media Network sponsored by WELS, the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod. Your show hosts are Martin Spriggs and Sally Draper. Join the conversation at WELSTech.WELS.net. Welcome back, good people. This is Martin Spriggs with WELSTech for October 15th, 2013. This is episode 311. And on this show, we talk about all things technology, at least as they relate to ministry. That's really our only criteria. And we're happy that you joined us. What a great opportunity it is to talk about things that make a difference, and that's ministry. Helping me do that each and every week, the lovely, the talented Sally Draper from New Ulm, Minnesota, just across the border. Hi, Sally.
Good morning, Martin. Happy to join you each and every week. Happy to talk technology and ministry. There's so much going on in that space. We don't seem to run out of things to talk about. That's a blessing.
That's right. That's right. Just sent my daughter back that way. She was home for the weekend. My son got married, so I have two married children now, and that's pretty cool.
Congratulations on that. That must have been a lot of fun.
It was. No incidents. Every wedding seems like it has something, and this was relatively incident free. So
smooth sailing, huh?
Yeah, absolutely. So it was a big party we had this weekend, and we asked the Lord to bless Aaron and Cheryl. So, and I know they are sometime listeners of the show. So if you are listening, blessings you too.
That's what I'd be doing on my honeymoon, listening to WELSTech.
See, they're not taking their honeymoon just yet, so okay. They're still in school and et cetera, et cetera. They're planning something later. Also want to give a shout out to Julia and Nathan Wagenknecht. They were passing through at the CMM Open House, which was last week. Our viewers may remember that I was in a tie last week too, and that was the reason last week. But they came in, they saw the studio that at least on the Waukesha side, and that was cool that they stopped in and said hello. So they're back from Mexico. They had some challenges over there, along with the Larry Schlomer family, where there was some issues with security down there, so they had to come back to the States. It's a wonderful thing. It's a blessing, obviously, that they are back here safe and sound, and that we have very dedicated people down there willing to risk their lives, their safety, for the sake of the gospel. We thank the Lord for what they do, and hopefully they'll be able to get back down there soon.
Well, very good. Thanks for the update. That's one of the blessings of being part of the WELSTech community. We do feel close because of these wires that connect us, and they certainly have contributed much to our community, and we wish them God's blessings.
Absolutely. All right. Speaking of wires and community and making the world a little bit smaller, one of the things that has contributed to that the world is flat kind of conversation is the world of mobile, as the internet not just is sitting in a big black box on your desk, but it is now sitting in your hands, and for many people going wherever they go. And I know, Sally, you have a new addition to your family, and the little iPhone that you have does the same thing for you.
That's right. I enjoy being connected all over the place, and one of my favorite things to be connected to is the WELS mobile app. Not sure if you're seeing it on your screen.
I see it.
Good stuff on the WELS mobile app.
And that's the topic for the day. And we've talked about the app off and on over the last year and a half or 2 years that it's been out there, and it's gone through a couple of revisions. But we felt, let's dedicate a show, at least the beginning part of a show, talking a little bit about it, what it can do for you, why you maybe would want it on your phone or tablet, and then where things are headed as well. So
I heard a rumor that it was really the only app you needed on your phone. Is that true?
That is true. Met a retired pastor who came through on the CMM open house, and he had just gotten a smartphone, and I told him he didn't have any apps on it. And I said, well, the WELS mobile app is probably the only one you really need, and he agreed. So
awesome. Start him off correctly.
That's right. That's right. Well, the WELS mobile app was just a little bit of history. It came out of a desire to bring the content, especially that is on WELS.net, to the mobile platform. We had a lot of requests over the years for a more mobile-friendly experience with the great content that is on WELS.net, and anybody that's visited there knows that, you know, there's lots of things that you can tune into or read or listen to every day, and kudos to our communication services group for pulling all that content together. That's not anything that my technology group does. They do that, and that is the content, for the most part, that makes up what is on the mobile app.
Yeah, definitely want to make use of all the channels, and mobile is probably the hottest channel to be on these days. Everybody has the technology in their pocket, it seems, and what better thing to have in your pocket than the Daily Word, the
right.
videos, and reports and things like the Together newsletter, just loads of great stuff that's packed into this little tiny app and available and constantly being updated. There's all kinds of new things being added every day.
I was working on it this weekend.
Very good.
So what I'd like to do, and I'm just showing, I'm sharing screen, and what I'm emulating here is an iPad, and I'm using a tool called Ripple. If you're not familiar with Ripple, it's a Chrome plugin that will allow you to emulate kind of a mobile platform right in your browser. It doesn't do all of the features, but many of the features, it works exactly like your phone or tablet would do, right down to geolocation even. So it's a very cool app if you do any kind of mobile development, or you just want to see how your website would look on a mobile platform. That's probably a great ministry use for it. So if you've got a website and are curious how it looks on different tablets or phones, you can pick the kind of phone or tablet that you want to view, and it will give you a close approximation as to how it might look and react on that platform. And that's probably something that all of our churches and schools should be thinking about, is how does your content perform in smaller formats? Because the numbers are astounding, actually, the rapid growth of those people just using tablets or phones to surf the internet. So it's really important to think along those lines. But
so
anyway,
Martin,
go ahead, Sally. Yeah.
We call that LangApp. You just gave us a little something extra. I thought we were talking about the WELS mobile app, but now we're going to have to put a link to Ripple in the show notes. So look for that in our show notes site.
Sorry, I added to your to-do list.
That's okay.
All right, so let's take a look at the WELS mobile app. I've got it up here on screen, and I'll try, and those of you that are just listening, I'll try and walk through it. Essentially, on the home screen, and by the way, I should tell people how to get the WELS mobile app. There are three different approaches to it. The one that I'd actually recommend is not through the traditional app stores, but would go in your mobile browser to m.wels.net. And the reason I say that, and I'll cover this in a tip, is that it is constantly getting the freshest and latest updates. So m.wels.net would be a place to get it, and that will come up right up in your mobile browser, and will look and feel exactly like the apps. And then we have two apps that are available, one in the iTunes store, if you just search for WELS Mobile, or in the Android or the Google Play Store, again, just search for WELS Mobile, and it will download, and it'll look exactly the same. So I'm using the m.wells.net version, but if you have the WELS mobile app at home that has been downloaded through iTunes or Android or the Play Store, then it should look almost exactly the same. Anyway, on the home screen, when it loads up, we've tried to categorize things by how people might like to consume content. So those that prefer to read, good old-fashioned text, we have a read section. We have an audio section, which includes all of our audio files, including this podcast. We have a video section, which includes anything that we've captured on video and is placed online, including this podcast. We have WELS Radio. We've talked about that in the past. We have a section called Synod Reports. We have quick links to our social apps. We have blogs. We have the ability to locate your closest WELS church or school. We have ways to contact us or the communication services group. We have an information sheet that talks about the latest release. We have help, some commonly asked questions, and a refresh button just to get the latest content. And then finally, one of the most popular pieces of content on the homepage, and in fact the only thing that actually changes on the homepage, and we're going to talk about how that might change in the future, is the verse of the day. And the verse of the day is Romans 12:2, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now, that may not sound like the Romans 12:2 that maybe you memorized in catechism class. That's because it's the new NIV, and the reason for that, I think we also talked about in the past, Sally, that's very scarce on the internet. And the service that I use to pull the verse of the day only provides NIV 2011. So that's what you get there. So those are the big buckets on the home screen. And just to give you a quick tour under the read section, we have all kinds of written content. Basically anything you can find on WELS.net, you can find here, other than kind of the more static content. So it's really not meant to be a regurgitation of the website per se, but stuff that is updated on a fairly regular basis. Things like daily devotions, Through My Bible, Worship Helps, Forward in Christ, and WELS Topical Q&A. Those are all things that come out each and every day or each and every week for the most part. And then you can always look at the current version or the latest release, or you can actually go back 10 releases in the case of, let's say, the daily devotion.
Pretty nice. You can read these online right in your browser there. So, and there's, you didn't mention at the top of the screen, a new releases that kind of mashes up all the everything, new stuff right, in one place.
Yep. So, one thing that we fairly recently added, Sally, was the current newsletter issues, and we have 4 newsletters that come out on a fairly regular basis. CLS, our Lutheran Schools Office, puts out a bi-weekly newsletter. Our Christian Giving Group has something called An Encouraging Word that talks about stewardship. Our Communication Services Group has an e-bulletin board which talks about some of the news around the Synod. And then our Special Ministry Group has a quarterly newsletter called His Hands, where they kind of group all the newsletters from all their various ministries. So all of those are updated, just a click away, and as you click into these, let's say if I go into the topical Q&A, you're going to get the latest questions. You don't get all the questions, and that may be something that we'll release in the future where you can do a search across all of the Q&A. Right now, I just pull from the latest 15 or 20 questions and answers just to keep people coming back and looking at the questions that get asked on WELS.net and answered. Another feature request is the ability to ask questions right here. That's not available right now, but you can do that in the future as I'm trying to roll out a new version. So that's it for read. Audio is very similar. We have the daily devotions through the Bible. We've added WELSTech podcast and military devotion. Those are all available, and if you click on them, you get a little player, or you can use your local player. One of the most popular things on WELS.net and also on the mobile app is the daily devotion. And I've heard lots of stories, and the through your Bible in 3 years. Those are two of the big ones. I've heard lots of people comment that or give us feedback that this is something that they use every day while they're walking or running or vacuuming or mowing the lawn or whatever. It's just something that they tune into right away in the morning sometimes, or in the evening after supper.
Yeah, our family gathers around the mobile device at breakfast and listens, and we feel like Pastor Mike Hens, who reads the daily devotion.
Part of the family.
Yeah. It's kind of neat to actually get to see him in person and hear his voice that we hear daily come to us with the wonderful message of
salvation.
Yeah,
they're just the right length. You know, they're about 5 minutes each, mm-hmm. so it's a quick verse and a quick illustration, and then just a little exposition of the passage and application to get you going, and then a prayer, which he's been doing, and he's very gracious to do this. He doesn't get paid any extra to do this. This is just a labor of love that he does this, and then he doesn't write all of these, just so that everybody's clear. They have a team of people across the Synod, volunteers, who will write devotions or series of devotions, kind of a similar mechanism that puts meditations together. So you've got authors that pull these together, they send them in. I should say that Mike does write some of them, but not most of them, and then he simply narrates them. But that takes some time, and it's kind of a taskmaster, because each week comes around and he needs to get these updated and into the system. And then our own Debbie Kameen in our technology group formats them, puts them online, and makes things go. So that's one of the most often used pieces of content on the mobile app and on WELS.net.
Yeah, you don't have any idea about subscribers or downloads or anything like that, do you?
Not for that particular piece of content.
I'd just be curious. I'm sure. I mean, just kind of working the help side of it and supporting people as they have questions about subscriptions, it's definitely one of the most popular things that's asked about. So.
Yeah, I'm sure we do. I don't have those at my fingers' tip, but yeah. I do have kind of rough numbers for downloads and usage of the mobile app, and it's in the 4,000 or 5,000 range.
Awesome.
At this point. So it's something that's getting some traction, and a lot of people are using it.
Word is spreading, and if you're listening today and haven't shared the good news about the WELS mobile app, maybe it's something you want to recommend to those in your congregation.
Yep, absolutely. And then just to give a quick rundown of the rest of the items here, one of the other most often used features of the mobile app is the good old call report. So you can get the latest and greatest call report by going to Synod Reports and then clicking on Call Report, and then you have all the latest call reports. So the latest one here is October 7th. There should be one coming out this week, I think. Is it this week? Yeah, I think this week. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's next week. They come out every 2 weeks, so you can click on that and see the call report that you can see online. So, and finally here, one of the things that I put a lot of work in on earlier in the year is the WELS yearbook, which is kind of cool. If you go into the WELS yearbook, you can search on any called worker or any church or school or WELS organization that exists. So if I wanted to see all the churches in New Ulm, I could type in New Ulm here and click search organizations, and I would get, oh, wow.
No, it's a happening place.
Yeah, no kidding. plus the schools that are there, including Martin Luther College, MVL. These are in different categories. That's why it's coming up multiple times. But there's preschools, there's elementary schools and such. And then you can also see who all the staff members are at a particular school and click on their names and get more information about them. So just kind of a WELS yearbook in your pocket. So if you're looking to even call somebody, you can do that via the WELS mobile app and just go to Synod Reports, look up somebody's name, and then you'll get their phone number that's listed in the WELS yearbook right there. And then if you tap on that, it's just going to ring on your phone or use your phone's dialer to ring them. So pretty cool.
Yeah, definitely. And that was something I didn't know about, so learning.
Really?
Yeah.
It's right there for you. And we've got some improvements, hopefully, there on the way as well. We have all the blogs on WELS.net. That's typical. That's pretty consistent with the read section. And then finally, the last thing I wanted to talk about on the mobile app is the locate function. And the locator will take either your current location, or you want to enter a location to find the nearest WELS organizations near you. So let's use New Ulm again. And then it's going to give you a little map, and then you can zoom in. It uses our current service provider for the locator search that is on the WELS.net website. So here I am in New Ulm, and we can see all of the WELS locations. And you just click on them, and a little box pops up. And you can see a little bit more information about them. You can even show the details about them, what their phone number is, how far they are from, let's say, your location. You can get driving directions, who the pastors are, website, email address, service times, those kinds of things. So,
very perfect for people that are traveling to have that kind of capability in their pocket. That's
absolutely
something that you definitely want to recommend for friends to make use of the app just for that reason.
Yep. So that, in a nutshell, is the current WELS mobile app. I was working over the weekend on improvements to it and kind of doing a redesign. And to make it more reliable and faster, it's fairly speedy now, but there are a couple of slow spots in it, so I'm just doing some performance improvements, and we may readjust how that home screen looks to get a little bit more newsy, put some news items on the home page, and then have kind of a more menu approach. So you just tap on a button, and then you can see all of the things that might be available in some drop-downs. So some changes are on the way. It's kind of a nights and weekends kind of thing for me. I don't have a lot of time during the day. So as I have time, I try and make some improvements and push those out to everybody.
So. Martin, you're really humble and very kind to all the different contributors to the app, but I should point out to our listeners that you are the man behind the WELS mobile app. That is a solo job, even though you say we are doing this. You've done a great job pulling together those resources and doing it in a new platform, basically, that's so diverse. You're trying to serve it up to so many different devices these days. That takes some work and a lot of testing, I'm sure, to make it work.
That's the big thing, yeah, because there are so many different platforms it could be used on, including the web itself. And that's maybe one of the new things I'm trying to build into it, so that if you do view it on a website, it has a pleasing aesthetic as well. So, and I enjoy it. I enjoy learning new technology. And this was when I first started, I knew nothing about mobile development. And by trade, I'm really not a programmer, so I'm picking up some of that too. So it's a step at a time, but I enjoy it.
Excellent. I want to point people, and we'll certainly have links in the show notes, but there's an icon on the WELS.net site, so if you're looking to learn more about the mobile app, you can choose this first icon in the upper right area that looks like the WELS logo, and you'll land on this mobile apps page. So there's kind of a rundown of what all's in the app. Maybe you're new to installing apps on your mobile device and you want to learn a little more about it. There's also links provided just to the mobile website, the m.wells.net, as well as the app stores for Android and iOS. So learn more and even watch a video overview. There's all kinds of goodies for you here on the WELS.net page to introduce you further to the WELS mobile app.
Yeah, good reminder. That's the place to grab all that stuff and learn a little bit more. All right, Sally, we should move along, and our next segment of the show is Ministry Resources.
That's right, Martin. And this week we heard from Pastor Rob, who's up in Kenai, Alaska, serving Grace Lutheran Church. And he is a techie at heart. And we always love it when we hear from Pastor Gunther. His emails are packed with good things. And one of the things he shared with us was this site, topscripture.com. And basically what this is a place to get a browser plugin. It works for Firefox, Chrome, and Safari. And on an hourly basis brings you the verse of the day. And interestingly, Martin, I've already seen it in my browser this morning, and it's the same verse of the day that you just quoted from the WELS mobile app. So they're pulling it from the same resource apparently. But that's great because that verse, and that's a good thing. I understand that it feeds you several verses throughout the day on a regular basis, but it's nice, as Pastor Gunther said, you can just take a little break and feast on God's Word, and a little reminder that pops into your browser and shows you that. So it is a plug-in. It's easy to install and quick, and it just kind of works in the background on your behalf and feeds you a little verse on a regular basis. So that's topscripture.com. And we thank you very much, Pastor Gunther, for contributing to our ministry resource section. That's something that we're encouraging all our listeners to do so that we can build up our ministry resources and share more of these useful tidbits with our listening audience. And there is something in it for you if you choose to share a ministry resource with us. We've got fabulous prizes to offer,
fabulous
Martin.
Prizes, yes. And our prize we announced last week for listener reviews, which we're going to get to in a second, present company excluded, would be entered to win a Nexus 7 tablet, one of the new ones from Google, which is a very nice tablet, $229 value. Actually, that when they say that on TV, you think, well, that's you can get it for a lot cheaper than that, and you can't. So that's what you'd pay if you bought it off the shelf. But that's what we're giving away for listener reviews. But for ministry resources, we thought we'd go the Apple route, you know, give fair time to the other side of the aisle, and we're going to give away an Apple TV, which is getting very popular, Sally, in the classroom. I know they're using it at Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary. A number of professors are hooking up their iPads to their Apple TVs and doing presentations that way. So a good ministry resource in and of itself. So that's what we'll be giving away. May 31st will be the drawing. And for you to get in, you simply need to give us a ministry resource that we would in turn share on the show. So Rob is in the pool.
Yep. And I'm sure there'll be many more that our listeners will share, but good opportunity to get in on that drawing.
So send us an email, put something in the show notes, you know, a comment on the show notes page. However you want to get in touch with us, let us know what ministry resource you found that has been helpful to you in your ministry, just like Rob did.
All right, time for listener reviews. And this week we have a review from yours truly, Sally Draper, freshly minted on the sallydraper.com website. And the title of the review is I'm a 5S-er. And believe it or not, this techie girl finally became a smartphone owner in the past. So as long as smartphones have been out, I know iPhones have been out since 2007, I have resisted the urge to go the smartphone route. Part of it is because I had really good wireless coverage and didn't stray very far from my wireless coverage in our previous location. Our church, school, and home were all wireless, and that's where I worked and did most of my time, and so having cell phone coverage wasn't a huge deal for me. But in a new location, cell phone coverage became a little bit more important to me, and so if we're going to do it, we may as well do it with the latest and greatest version of the cell phone. My husband chose to go the Android route. He got a Galaxy 4S. or S4, I think it is. S is on the other side. But I waited, I held out for the new iPhone. And the version that I got was the 32 gig space gray color. So no blingy gold iPhone for me, just a good old space gray. And it arrived last Wednesday. I've tracked it all the way, very excited to have it coming to me. And, you know, my review and initial reaction is probably different than most iPhone owners, because for most people, this is their new rendition of an iPhone they've had previously. And that's not the case with me. I don't have any smartphone history, so I'm just kind of wowed by the fact that I'm connected all the time. The fact that my data plan lets me access all my goodies from wherever I'm located. And so that's just huge and very exciting for me. I do notice a speed difference from my iPad, because I have been an iPad girl for several years, and so obviously there is that to compare to, and I think that was one of the big improvements with the iPhone 5S was like a 64-bit processor and the LTE network and that kind of thing. And you know, my big impression is like, wow, it is really fast. So in technical terms, wow. Yeah, it is a fast access. I didn't know things could move that quickly on the internet. I also am excited for new features. I have definitely made use of the fingerprint recognition. That's probably getting the most press with the iPhone. The fact that you can actually unlock the phone without having to type in a passcode. You can just press with your finger and it will unlock. It takes a moment to learn your fingerprint. You have to kind of give it some time to scan your fingerprint multiple times and get all the nuances of it. It asks you to do it at different angles and things like that. But I can tell you that I used my right hand and my right thumb to scan, and it won't recognize my left thumb even. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely got my mark on this particular iPhone. So
that was pretty cool. You can do multiple fingers, you know.
Yeah. I also am enjoying, for me, the new feature of having a GPS. That's something I haven't had on my devices because I didn't have cell coverage on my iPad or whatever. So that's something I think I'm going to be learning more about and using more. It came with some built-in apps, and those were kind of the basics to help you get started. Your camera and your video, FaceTime, the app store, your mail and clock, those kind of things. Very standard for initial installation. But what I was surprised by was that Apple also gave you the option of installing some of their premium apps for free. So over the years, I've paid for iPhoto, iMovie, Keynote, Pages, Numbers, those kind of things. And now, with this release of the iPhone series, they offered those to their customers for free. Of course,
that's great.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely an added value, but probably a lot of their customers are like me, already have Apple accounts and have paid money for those apps in the past. Mm-hmm. But if you're new to it or if you never purchased those apps, that's probably, I don't know, I'm guessing maybe $30 or $40 worth of apps.
Yeah, for sure.
Their apps aren't cheap, you know, $5 or $10 a pop for some of their premium apps, and now you get them for free with this version. So that's really nice. What was pretty interesting to me was what to put on the phone from my existing Apple account. So once I got past the apps that came with it, the apps that I could download for free from Apple, then I logged into my existing Apple account, and I had access to hundreds, I will say, of apps that I've installed on my iPad in the past. And before my iPad, I had an iPod Touch. So all those apps are sitting there on my account, and I can pick and choose from those. So then it became, well, you know, what do I really want? What do I want to clutter up my brand new clean phone with? You know, I don't want to put 100 apps on it right off the bat and stuff. So what's really important? And right off the bat, I had to install the WELS mobile app and the YouVersion Bible. Those are probably two of my most hot items on my current iPad, so I wanted to make sure I got those on there. And then I enjoy doing a lot of image work on my iPad, so I thought I'd need my favorite image editor. It's called Photogene, and Instagram. That's one of my favorite apps to be able to just apply some fun filters and share things socially on the internet. So those were some of the very first ones that I installed, and I made use of it right away on Friday night. Went to MLC for the Divers concert. That's kind of a really fun annual event that MLC hosts. The Divers, which is a band, a local band out of Bethany, actually, in Mankato. So they were at MLC, and I took a fabulous photo of them with no flash and low light and all of that, and proved that the camera that's built into the iPhone is decent quality. Yeah. So I'm off and running with my iPhone 5S. I'm excited about it, and I'm sure I have plenty to learn. Maybe Siri can teach me. I spoke to her a little bit this weekend, and so hopefully I'll have more to share from the iPhone world in the coming weeks, but that's my initial review of my 5S. Love it.
Good.
Yep.
All right. Sorry I can't enter you in that drawing, however. So
that's okay.
You've already got a tablet anyway. So.
Yeah.
So are you finding that you're using your iPad less now?
You know, I feel like I'm betraying it. It's been my constant companion for over 2 years, and here I am with the new kid on the block. I'm dividing my time evenly as best I can.
Okay. I find that there are just some things that play better on a bigger screen.
Yeah.
So it's... they're not interchangeable, but for quick things, I think the convenience of having something that's always with you, which would be your phone, is a good thing. So
definitely.
Let's move on to our tip of the week. Sally, I'll go first. My tip, and I'll just do a quick screen share here as well, is the ability to go to the WELS mobile app. We'll keep it in that theme, or any website, but I'll use WELS mobile as an example. So let's say you take my advice and you want to go to m.wels.net and make that kind of your go-to for the edition you prefer for WELS mobile. So you would go to your, in this case, let's say your Android phone, and I have included instructions here that would allow you to take a website like m.wels.net and make it into a little icon on your home screen so it acts just like an app. Essentially, it's a shortcut that's made into a little icon that you can click on your home screen. It'll open up your, in Android's case, probably your Chrome browser, whatever your default browser is, and it'll load the app or load m.wels.net automatically. And it's not real intuitive, I don't think, on Android like it is on iOS, which I'll talk about in a minute. But on Android, it's fairly straightforward. You simply need to, first of all, go to the app that you want or go to the website that you want. And then on Android, there are these three little, at least in the latest editions of Android, these three little buttons or three little dots at the top right, which is the drop-down menu. You go there and then you click the little star icon, which will ask you to add a bookmark. You can give it a name. You can tell it where. Normally you'll just keep it in mobile bookmarks. And then once you're done with that, you need to go back in, open your bookmarks again, long press on the one that you just created, and then you'll get a little pop-up that'll say add to home screen. So that's what you're after. And once you've done that, it will appear as a as an item right on your home screen, just right along with your other apps, and you can treat it just like an app. You can move it around, you can put it in a folder, and so on and so forth. For iOS, it is a very similar process, and I've got my iPad here. And so once you're on the WELS mobile app, iOS 7 is different than iOS 6 in how you do this. The icon has changed. For iOS 7 at the top of your mobile browser. So first of all, you go to Safari, you go to the WELS mobile app, and then once it's up, m.wels.net, I'm sorry, you go to m.wels.net in Safari. Then at the top, next to the address bar, there's this little box now, a square with an up arrow. So once you click on that, it's actually very easy from there. iOS has made it pretty simple, where you simply have a bunch of selections where you can share this through different things. Oops, let's cancel that. And then one of them says Add to Home Screen. So once you click Add to Home Screen, it asks you for the name. You click Add, and then it pops up with the logo. If there's a favicon, it will use that, and that will become the app icon. So when you click on this now, once it's on your home screen, it'll open up, and it'll open up Safari. It'll load the app just like it's in an app window. It even gets rid of the URL bar at the top, so you have more screen real estate. So that's one advantage to doing that on iOS 7. They've done a nice job with the ability to take those mobile apps or mobile websites and turn them essentially into apps. So that's what I would recommend, and that is my tip of the week. And that'll work for any device. And one of the reasons that you may want to use m.wels.net rather than download the app is that you need to be online to access the content anyway. There's not downloadable content in the app, at least right now. So you're getting the same experience, but you're also getting the latest releases. It takes a lot longer for me to get those in an app, an Android or an iOS version. It's got to go through the stores. It has to be approved. Sometimes that's a 2 or 3 week process. Certainly on iOS it is. So I'm updating the m.wels.net side a lot faster than I am the apps side. So that's a good reason to maybe use this versus something else. So.
Little insider information there. That's good to know.
Absolutely.
Martin, I'm wondering if you can look into your crystal ball and predict the future. Do you think more and more will go to just the mobile interface, the browser interface, as more and more apps
are
developed?
There's debates every day on the internet about that amongst developers. I think developers would prefer that.
Yeah.
I would prefer that, so I don't have to create three versions, because I can't just repackage the mobile, the website into an app. There's a lot of things that I have to do to make it work. One of the reasons that it hasn't kind of taken off, at least that approach hasn't taken off, is that there still are some things that you can't do on a phone or a mobile device, like getting into some of the hardware. That's why you need to write an app specifically to take advantage of let's say the gyroscope or, you know, things like that. So I think that's kind of holding it back with some features. Now, for the WELS mobile app, not a big deal. Whether you're in the mobile app or the website, the only thing that I really use with the phone is the geolocation. Available, so that's not a big deal. So that's why I say you're not really losing anything. But if I were to use I think there are some areas with the camera and things like that, so if I were to use more of that, then there would be some more challenges. So,
I could see you having it, you know, shake if you want to, I don't know, read the next devotion or whatever. You never know what that gyroscope might come in handy. Who knows?
That's right. That's right. So, that's my tip.
All right, good stuff. I have a tip to share as well, and it's related to your Google Calendar. I'm sure there are many who are listening that make use of Google Calendar like I do. And one thing I do rely on heavily is my daily agenda email. And what comes to me each morning at 5 a.m. is all the calendars that I choose, all the events on those calendars in one email combined. So let me demonstrate that for you. If you're on your Google Calendar, there's a down arrow next to the My Calendar link in the left column, and you can actually get to your global calendar settings with that down arrow. And it typically will come up on a screen that shows your list of calendars, shows reminders and notification links, sharing, that kind of thing for your list of calendars. At the very bottom of that list, way down low, I take it back, I'm sorry, you have to go into a specific calendar. So if I go into my Sally Draper calendar reminders and notifications and go to the very bottom of that list, there's a link that says daily agenda. And you can check to indicate that you'd like email of a daily agenda at 5 a.m. in your current time zone. You have other options for notifications, like if things are changed on your calendar or whatever, particularly with shared calendars, that's nice. But this daily agenda then comes to you as one single email. So you need to, and I should have used my back button. Let me go forward. Oh, I lost it. There it goes. Okay, so back into my calendar settings. So you need to go into each individual calendar. So if I'm interested in getting the WELSTech podcast recording schedule, I'd go into reminders there and check the box for daily agenda. And so for each individual calendar, you need to save those settings indicating whether you want the daily agenda. And then, like I said, you get the one mashup email that has events from all those calendars included in your email. So that's kind of how I start my morning, is by checking my email to find out what's on my daily agenda. So easy and free to do with your Google Calendar.
Does it aggregate them, or do you get a separate email for each calendar?
It's all in one daily agenda email.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Very nice. That I did not know. I know I'd seen that before, that I received an email. I didn't know where it came from, and then it stopped, so I must have turned that setting off or whatever. But if you use Google Calendars, that's wonderful. You
know, it is. It's a good way to start the day.
Right in front of you. Yep, absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's move on to our picks of the week.
And I go first there, and my pick of the week is a brand new app on my iPhone to make use of the GPS capabilities I finally have. I can use RunKeeper, and there's RunKeeper apps for your iOS or Android device. But I'll give you a full disclaimer right up front. I am not a runner. You can switch it to WalkKeeper as well. But what's neat about it is it actually tracks, using GPS technology, your particular workout, whether it's a run or a walk or a bike or whatever it may be, and it gives you all kinds of logistical data based on that. So as you're doing your workout, as you're walking or whatever, you can have it tell you every 5 minutes how you're doing. You know, so you're 20 minutes in and you've walked 1.2 miles and you're doing it at whatever pace you're doing it at, and it'll just kind of verbally tell you those things on an incremental basis as you're working out. So that's kind of fun. My husband and I have a route that we walk that takes us up the New Ulm Hill, which is just a killer for me, and we do it right off the bat. So we start up this really steep hill, and our pace is not that great. But then once we get to the top of the hill and eventually down the hill, our pace definitely improves. So we're listening at those 5 minute increments to hear you know, how fast we're going and whether it's in keeping with the last time we did our walk or whatever. Then at the end of your walk, it gives you all those stats for your complete walk. And I'm just trying to bring up on my computer an image I included in my review of the iPhone. Let's see if I can share that. It gives you the stats and a map of where you have walked. So with the GPS technology, then it shows you the complete route. It tells you how far you walked, how many calories you burned, how long it took you, what your overall pace was. Oh, and there's my top scripture popping up on the screen.
Yes.
So yeah, and it also gives you kind of milestones as you set a higher pace, a faster pace, then it'll keep up with your best workout ever kind of information and tell you if you're, you know, approaching those milestones and things. So lots of technology built into the RunKeeper app. I'm really excited now with the GPS to be able to make use of it, and hopefully over time it's going to be motivational. It sent me an email and said, you want to work out today, yep. You know, and right. things like that. So hopefully it's going to motivate me to keep a good walking schedule and enhance my stats to get better and better.
Cool.
Yeah.
And it's for Android and iOS. I noticed, I've got it. I have not used it yet. I used to use something called Endomondo, whatever that means. But RunKeeper is much nicer looking, which probably makes sense since it started on the iOS platform. So I'm going to start using that one. And it tracks via GPS, so it does drain your battery a little bit depending on how far you're going and what your location is. But you can also share directly to Twitter and Facebook, so another little piece of motivation. So.
Get the social community behind you, huh?
That's right. Go, Sally.
Yeah.
All right. My pick of the week is a rerun, but I picked it because I've been using it quite a bit lately and been very impressed with its usefulness and stability, and that's join.me. I can do a quick screen share again. Join.me is a screen sharing application, but they've added some nice features. One of those features, let me just pull up the features page here, is the ability to have people call in. So not only can you screen share, but you can have people call or dial directly in via either voice over IP or with a toll phone number. So they would call not an 800 number, but a regular phone number, and they can join the conference and also see the presentation. You can share control. You can use multiple monitors or the chat feature. You can send files. There's viewer apps for iPad and Android or iPhone. So those are all very useful. If you upgrade to the Join.me Pro, which I use, you can have up to 250 participants. You can do recordings, so you can record your sessions. There's some annotation. You can swap presenters. There's an app that you can download that gives you a couple of extra features, and you can even present from the iPad. You can lock meetings, send out invitations, those kinds of things. The base configuration, the base package, the free version is, of course, free. The pro version, just right out of the box, is $149 a month if you pay, or $149 a year if you pay by the year for one presenter, or $19 monthly. But they do have nonprofit pricing, and you have to email them to get that pricing. But it's a pretty good deal, especially if you're going to use it on a regular basis. So if you need to offer technical support or do a lot of presentations, maybe even distance learning, you know, this would be an opportunity to use this where you could record the session. I think it's, to me, Sally, I don't know, you've used it, and I think that I think it's a stronger solution than what maybe Skype offers, and maybe even what Google Hangouts offers, because you have all that integration and the recording functionality. The recordings, unlike Google Hangouts, aren't made public right away. So you keep those private. So if you're teaching distance learning to, let's say, your catechism class, that would be a concern. And I've never had a problem with this working. You can send out a link, or you can have them log into a URL, your own personal URL. And I've never had any trouble getting anybody in. It's a very smooth, seamless process. And just it's by LogMeIn, which is a Citrix product, and they really know what they're doing when it comes to screen sharing and this conferencing stuff. So that's my pick.
Good pick. I was just going to say, in contrast to Google Hangouts, from the user's perspective, from the participant's perspective, they don't have to have an account of any kind.
Do anything. Yeah, right.
So you send them to the correct page. If you have the pro account, you have a customized URL that you send them to. Otherwise, you give them a number to put in.
Yep.
And it does maybe a quick download on their end to be able to see the screen share, but there's no logging in or any passwords required or anything like that. It's very simple to share. I use it with my mom. Hi, Mom. She's watching, I'm sure. Okay. And that's how I can get on her computer and, you know, help her, assist her.
Cool.
Yeah.
Let's move on to our of interest section. Is there anything going on in the WELS world?
Sure, just a quick mention of live streaming. I thought I had a window open, but I don't. But that's okay, because it's off in the future. It's coming up on November 17th, a really exciting event at our Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary, their Seminary Anniversary Festival Service. It's their 150th year this year of the Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary, and they're having a special service to commemorate that. So you'll want to make plans to tune in November 17th at 3 p.m.
Community feedback.
It's time to whiz through all those great links that Pastor Gunther sent us, because he sent us a bunch of good ones, starting with SoundGecko, where you can listen to news, websites, and documents. So if you are not into the reading thing, maybe you prefer to listen. Have it read to you. That's right. And he's had great experience with it, and you may want to try it out as well. He said he's also making use of speech recognition on his Windows 8 computer, which is apparently baked into the operating system, and you know, telling it to open his browser or whatever it may be. And you know, for those of you that are really into productivity, you know, the less that your hands have to leave the keyboard and work with the mouse, the more productive and speedier you are. And voice recognition is upping the ante for Pastor Gunther. So
use all the tools God gave you, not just your fingers, but your voice as well.
I also want to make mention of the Make Use Of site. We are big fans of Make Use Of, and Pastor Gunther shared a article they released recently called The Ultimate If This Then That Guide. Using the web's most powerful tool like a pro. And I know Pastor Gunther's a fan. I'm a fan of If This Then That as well. Basically, you cook up recipes of triggers. So, for instance, if a new calendar event goes on your calendar, then it will also email a group of people or something to that effect, so that your life is connected through this website that kind of controls connections. It's an interesting thing.
Do you have a favorite recipe, Sally?
I like to archive my photos from Instagram. I mentioned earlier that I'm an Instagram girl, and but I also like the fact that I'm storing them in my Flickr site, which is pretty much what I use for all my photo archiving.
Oh, makes sense, yeah.
So, yeah, anytime I upload something to my Instagram site, the If This Then That website kicks in and archives it over to my Flickr site in a particular location on Flickr, a set for my Instagram photos. So, yeah.
Cool. I use it in conjunction with File This, so that what it does is it links up the ability to grab, let's say, statements, a credit card statement, a bank statement, and automatically pushes it over to Evernote. So I have a recipe set up where I can, anytime I get a new statement, it goes directly into Evernote, because a lot of my statements don't come in the mail anymore. They're all online, but I still want a hard copy for tax purposes or whatever. So that just kind of automates the process for me. So if you're not familiar with IFTTT, if this, then that, you may want to take a look at it. It's a very useful utility for connecting the web.
And these recipes are out there for you to absorb. You don't have to make up your own. You can review what people are doing with Instagram recipes or, you know, whatever your tool is that you'd like to make use of. So, good stuff.
Yep. Thanks, Rob.
All right.
And he's not done. Doesn't he have something else yet? Or is he done?
I think that was
he's done. All
the
right.
bulk
That's
of it from Pastor Gunther. Yep. So we're moving on to DIGO links. For those of you that are new to WELSTech, we have a DIGO group, and that's a great way for you to share links with us. And we have a new contributor in our DIGO group. Teacher Justin Groth shared Ginzy.com. I would guess that's how you pronounce it, GYNZY.com. And this is software to use with your interactive whiteboard. And I'm excited about this. You know, one of the things that smart boards have going for them in the smart interactive system is their notebook software, which has a lot of wonderful bells and whistles baked into it. But you have to be a smart board owner to get access to the notebook software. Ginzy looks like kind of a parallel to the smart notebook software, giving you a lot of objects and things to work with on your interactive whiteboard. So maybe you've exhausted your smart notebook software and are looking for something new, or maybe you aren't a smart notebook user. Instead, you use a different interactive whiteboard solution, or you just want to bring some of these cool solutions to your projection. It's possible that Ginzy could be a solution that you could make use of, so check it out. And thanks, Justin, for contributing to our DIGO list. Another regular contributor on the DIGO list is Jason Smith, and he hasn't disappointed. This week he shared several links, including the digital driver's license. So here's resources if you're a student or teacher or even want to make use of in your complete school district. Digital, being a good digital citizen, digital literacy and citizenship resources. Looks like it's even available for iOS, so maybe if you have iPads in your classroom, you could make use of it as well. Digital driver's license. Also from Jason, a link to a presentation about the SAMR model. Martin, you and I have talked about SAMR before in the past. It's kind of a digital adoption methodology, basically looking at the fact that when you have new devices or digital technology, you go through a process of substitution, augmentation, modification, and redefinition, so that it's not just about adding a tool to an existing process, but modifying your teaching methodologies and expectations of your students to include the use of the tools available to them. And this presentation, I'm just looking kind of at the beginning screen, but it actually walks you through some of those concepts of SAMR and the redefinition that happens with the tools. Finally, from Jason, he linked to Zotac and said that Zotac potentially was good for driving digital screens, I believe. So this is basically a computer solution that would be good if you're trying to put up some digital signage in your location. Says it comes highly recommended as a unit to power a digital display using Rise Vision server software. Jason thought it looked promising, so if you're looking into digital display, perhaps you want to check out the Zotac Z-Box.
Okay.
And then just very quickly, a couple of links from me. This was something that came across my reading from Barna Group. They do a lot of online surveying, particularly in the Christian space, and they are introducing a new book product called Barna Frames. Did you hear about this, Martin?
I did not.
It made me smile because the whole concept behind Barna Frames is the typical person doesn't have entire weekends anymore to spend reading a book. But that doesn't mean we don't want to learn. That's why we've created Frames, which is a book series, short yet deep digestible reads on a top issues facing Christians. What does that remind you of, Martin? Unable to read books. Maybe that's our book selection.
The Shallows,
yeah, huh? Yeah. So these guys at Barna, they read The Shallows, and now they're marketing to the fact that our brains are different and we can't read deep, long books. So they're creating mm-hmm. books in short format. Thought it was kind of interesting. We'll be looking and seeing what's coming out in the Frames.
Interesting.
I read about a new digital design product called Canva. Looks like it'll be fun to work with for collages and overlays and things like that. It's in beta right now, so if you want to sign up for it, you can create a username and they'll be in touch with you when you can get into your Canva account. Looks like a fun Web 2.0 tool of the future. And then finally,
design tool for non-designers.
That's the kind of person I am, so yeah, good stuff. Last one is a webinar coming up from Simple K through 12. It's called Discover How to Launch a Successful School iPad Program, and it will be running this Thursday, October 17th from 3 to 3:30 Eastern Time. So if you're looking or considering iPads for your school, you might want to sit in on this free webinar.
Okay, cool. That looks like that's going to do it for community feedback. If you would like to contribute your own stuff, and we wish you would, go to wellstech.wells.net, leave a comment, or across the top, all kinds of icons that you could click on to get in touch with us. Some lead to Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, our email address. You could even leave a good old-fashioned voicemail. There's a little box that'll pop up on the right side of the screen, and away you go.
I love you say that it's good old-fashioned. You're talking to your computer, and that's old-fashioned.
Yep. Well, voicemail's been around a long time.
I guess
it is a different mechanism.
A little twist.
A little twist, yes. And I say that every week, so it must be true. Next week, we are going to be talking about web accessibility. If you are a webmaster, you will not want to miss this one because this is maybe something you're not thinking about and you should. I had a meeting last year with some special ministry folks that were going through the WELS mobile app and the WELS.net website and pointing out some challenges that they had navigating the site because they were using tools like screen readers because they were sight impaired, so they couldn't see like the, you know, with the 20/20 vision, and had to rely on the tools that are provided by your browser or by your mobile device to actually navigate through a website. And hopefully, we're going to have Aaron Spike, formerly from Martin Luther College, who's worked in some, who's fairly up to date on the latest and greatest in web accessibility. So that's going to come up next week.
Looking forward to it.
Yeah, it'd be cool. And finally, I noted last week that we are not going to be playing WELS artists' music at the end of the show anymore. We're going to provide a little bit different resource, and that's we're going to give you a free download of one of those WELS artists each week. So for the next 7 days, you'll be able to go. I forgot how we're doing this, Sally. Did we decide? We're going to put a link on our show notes page. Is that correct?
That's the idea, Martin. We're going to figure it out this week.
Okay. Go to our show notes page. You'll find something there that'll tell you how to do this. But basically,
right,
we're going to provide a download link to an artist each week. This week's artist is Mike Wessendorf, and we'll also put a link to his website there, and also a place for you to grab the song Come, one of his songs, I think from one of his latest albums, and you'll be able to download that for your very own self and keep that as long as you like on whatever device you want. There's no DRM, so you can put it on your iPad, your iPhone, your Android, your computer, into your iTunes, and play that over and over and over again. And then until next week when we do another artist and another download. So our thanks certainly to Mike Wessendorf for allowing us to do that and all of our other WELS artists who have agreed to this program. So enjoy the song Come. Sally, that's going to conclude our work for the day, at least on the WELS Tech podcast. Please tune in next week, and blessings on your use of technology in ministry. Bye-bye, everybody.